So Phil, Phil is a anxiety solution coach.
That's great.
So his journey to finding an anxiety solution started when he was beset by fear when he sat for his HSC exam in 88 at the age of 17. His first attempts were made to control anxiety using mindfulness meditation. And he found that it was good, it was a straightforward technique, but didn't actually address the underlying problem. So he sort of dug down, he studied extensively at the Centre for Human Transformation in Melbourne for over a decade. He came to a much more robust and grounded place within himself, and he was behaving a lot less like a detached know-it-all since the beginning of age 12. His learnings came from a teacher who was fully conversant with philosophy, comparative religion, scientific research, and Australian Indigenous spiritual traditions. So he's now led over 100 group breath journeys over the last decade. He's co-facilitated breath retreats for over 5 years. And Phil is always profoundly humbled by the sudden transformations that occur during that breath journey. So now he has a thriving breath training retreat business in Australia.
I'll talk to this in a minute. Good morning, everyone. So I'm going to make a bold claim. I don't make bold claims very often, but I've decided I'm going to make a bold claim. I'm going to make a claim that if you consciously breathe, you'll have the equivalent effect or better than a doctor giving you antidepressant medication if you're depressed. Say if you went and said, oh, doctor, I'm depressed, I'm more mentally anxious. Conscious breathing would be equally as good, if not better, than the results you can get from a doctor prescribing pills to you. Except in the cases of like schizophrenia or severe bipolar disorder or all those sort of things. So, conscious breathing is so cheap. It's just here, it's everywhere, right? So, and you can do it at any time. So, really, I'm talking myself out of the business. Now, the difference between breathing consciously in the day-to-day life and actually having paying someone to be with you for a full 2.5 hour session is quite a lot. So the main difference is that when someone is on your case, you do better, right? So if you just lie down and breathe consciously for say 30 minutes, you'll feel slightly better and you'll feel probably more relaxed because you're lying down. But if you've got someone on your case telling you to breathe fully and keep the breath going through the mouth, keep it going, there's no hole in the breath, and just keep this big loop going for a full hour, there's a much bigger difference because one, you're being witnessed, you're being seen. I don't fully understand how that works, but basically there's some mechanism where if you know you're being watched, you'll do better, right? So, and you will be able to help, you'll be able to be, if you have any emotions associated with the breath or holding your breath, if someone has witnesses that, then you'd have a way to reveal that to somebody, and it also helps a sense of relief in the body. So essentially in breath work, there's lots of breath work out there, and it gets really confusing because there's so many different traditions of how to breathe, right? You've got, you know, there's breath improvements through exercise physiology schools, there's breath improvements through yoga. This type of breathing that I teach is something called breath work or rebirthing. It came out of, if you want to go back far enough, Europe in the 1920s, but basically came out of the hippie movement in California in the 60s. And the idea was that how do you get people to go into their psyche without using talk therapy? So this is how you do it, I'll show you. I pretend I'm lying down. This is what you do. You have some music playing, right? This is it. That is it. But you keep going for a full hour. So what happens in the first 10 to 15 minutes, it feels like hell. It feels difficult. It feels like, oh God, why is this guy making me breathe so much? Like I'm starting to feel dizzy. I'm like, what's going on? Like, this is just really difficult, or I feel tired, or this is like nothing's happening. So once you hit the 15-minute mark, something else opens up. And what opens up is more feeling or more sensation in the body. How many people have had bodily pains where the doctor goes, I don't know what's wrong with you. I've done all the scans and nothing's, not, I can't, I don't know what's wrong with me. You know, the doctor goes, just puts you away and says, what's wrong with you? Nothing's wrong with me. There's pain. So breathwork's very good at seeking out these bodily pains. Often it's sort of to do with the nervous system's way of holding on to usually emotional difficulty or some sort of emotional tension that's in your life or external input, and this helps move it around and break that up. So I want to start with anxiety and where it starts. So father, mother, they're my mum and father. So often if the mother is anxious about getting pregnant, or they might not be anxious about actually getting pregnant, but once they're pregnant, they might be anxious about what's going to happen next, all those sort of things. They could be not wanting the baby, all those sort of things. So if you want to go deep into mother's womb space in here, when you're a little thin growing and your mother has a lot of anxieties or some anxiety, or you know, you're really welcomed, but then there's something that goes wrong, like a parent dies or something. All those subtle things impact on your nervous system. And those little things affect how you respond as a baby once you come out the mother's womb. So there is like an emotional feeling flow that goes back between the fetus and the mother and how she's feeling at the time. So in my case, I was a wanted child. I was a loved child, but I had, you know, a lot of difficulty getting out of the womb at birth. So a lot of people's underlying patterns of anxiety can come from birth trauma. So if there was a lot of intervention, if there was a long protracted labour and the mother didn't feel supported, often that will transfer into the baby's nervous system, like the sense of being wanted or welcomed, or, you know, et cetera, et cetera. So that can set up patterns and layering. Breath work helps to unravel that. So if you had a particularly difficult birth, that breath work is a wonderful way to deal with it. Now, if I just have clients day to day and you're walking around Canberra and going, you see people and they want to get off antidepressants, or they're just anxious or depressed, or got a fear of flying, or they get anxious about driving, or almost any possible trigger out there, send them to me as a possibility, because breathwork doesn't just work on the... It does work at this layer of, you know, moving forwards to, you know, a childhood trauma. And I tell you what, as a childhood trauma driving to Queensland and one of those and back from Melbourne, as a child, during summer...
No aircon.
Yeah, we couldn't afford aircon at that stage. Aircon was available in the early 70s, but it's very expensive. So there's all sorts of reasons that we can, like, walk around with our wounding and rah, rah, rah. I'm not a person who celebrates people's victimhood. I'm not a person who celebrates their trauma. I'm a person who helps their trauma and gets... I want people to be successful. So this is not about, like, oh, my God, you poor thing. Like, I'm a therapist who has empathy, but I'm not a person who indulges people's victimhood. So I want to make that clear. But also... in terms of performance, like, anxiety can really trip you up at the most difficult moments. Public speaking, doing exams, as I found out in HSC, like, it's like, whoa, my pounds are sweating. I'm like, my performance in HSC was okay, but it probably could have been better if I learned how to do a few techniques beforehand, like how to breathe properly. So what I do is breath work. The business is called the Anxiety Solution, and there are a lot of ways to de-stress, but this is a way that can last over time. So this stuff sticks, right? And it sticks a long time in the body. I want to show you one more. We're going to skip through a few things. This is getting quite family albums, but where's the, how do I go? So I want to tell you about, I know I've only got a short amount of time. So I'm about 10 years old there. when I was 11, the next year I went to Europe, and one of the things that motivates me is the human condition, right? So the human condition can be great, it can also be very dark, and it can be very heavy and miserable. So when we went to Munich, we had an uncle who lived in Munich, and we went out to Dachau concentration camp, which was like a political prisoner camp under the Nazi regime in the 1930s up until the end of the war. And we went out there, and as an 11-year-old boy, I was like, whoa, what's this place? This is weird, you know? It was like, whoa, watchtowers and like sort of a few barracks that were left, a lot of them demolished. And it finally hit me as an 11-year-old kid. It was just like, wow, what humans do to each other? Like, this is really interesting. I just found it fascinating. So what motivates me is like, an attempt to help human beings deal with the darker aspects of their psyche. So breath work really helps people dive into that. It helps them face it. It helps them deal with the difficulty and darkness that often is down there. So I don't shy away from any of that intensity in with my clients, and that's why I tend to get results. So thank you very much for listening to me this morning. Sessions are 2.5 hours and they cost around $220.
We do thankfully have a couple of minutes, so if anybody has any questions quickly.
Yeah.
So, thanks, Phil. So, you're talking about breath work being good for emotional sort of issues. Does it help in any other physical sort of benefits, such
yes.
as asthma or whatever else?
Yes, I love people who have asthma. Right. So, asthma is often, I think, related to something to do with the way the baby, when you came out of the womb and the first breath. So if the first breath was taken in like fear or shock, that sort of stuff, like, so that can be a pattern that's underlaid from birth.
Even contracted as I am.
Yes. Yep. So I'm happy to work with people with that sort of condition. And it tends to help ease symptoms. I don't know if it cures it, but it can certainly ease the symptoms and reduce the intense attacks of asthma. And because most people don't want to rely on ventolin for their whole life if they can avoid it. So yes, physical back pain, that they might be going to the physio and they can't do anything about it. This breath work can be good just for physical conditions.
Awesome.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah.
I got a question. You talked about the influence of stress. While the baby's growing in the womb. There's lots of research on that. It's really interesting.
Yeah.
Have you also looked at the genetics and epigenetics as well?
I understand a bit of epigenetics. I don't understand a lot about it, but I do know that there's a lot of going on between the grandparents and the sort of slight influences and genetic programming that happens from grandparents down to grandkids. Often they'll skip the parents. So if your grandparents have particular issues, they can be manifest more in the babies. So genes are responsive to environment. So basically, if there is severe memories of famine or difficulty or a severe emotional pain or war trauma from grandparents, that can be passed to the parents and the grandkids. And I don't understand how that mechanism fully works, but it's about how the genes respond to external influence and how they get passed down through genetically.
So when you see someone, do you sort of ask them about their family history of the anxiety?
Yes. My grandfather's war trauma is particularly useful to understand my anxiety and depression. I haven't had depression, my anxiety. My grandfather's war trauma is particularly useful to understand why I was like I was. I totally get it. So I used to have incredible chest pains on the right side of my chest. I didn't understand what that was all about, but then I find out he was injured on the right side of the chest. Strategy. So, you know, like that sort of stuff is useful to know. Yeah.
And Harry, last question.
And whereabouts do you practice?
Weston Creek. I work at a clinic space with another colleague of mine called Suzanne Zankin, and it's a suburban house, a big A-frame house. It's a very nice place in 261 High Marsh Drive.
Awesome.
Rivette.
Yeah.
Thank you.